Thank you. Today, you will be receiving presentations from myself, along with regional affairs directors from regions 3, 4, and 5, and our vice president of communication and our community organizer, co-doer. Next slide, please. We'd like to make this a space where you can network with other student trustees. So please put in your name, your college major and position, and what you'd hope to get out of this webinar in the chat, please. The purpose of this retreat is to provide you with resources from the perspective of student leaders. We're going to discuss how to engage with your campus and basically, as I mentioned, facilitate an opportunity for you to network with other trustees. Next slide, please. The SSCCC, who we are. The SSCCC, the Student Senate for California Community College, is a student-led and staff-supported 501c3 nonprofit organization representing over the 1.8 million students of California Community Colleges. Next slide, please. The SSCCC mission and vision. The mission is to enrich the collegiate experience for all community college students by pursuing policies that improve student access and success. And we do that through our vision, and that is provided by communicating a unified student perspective to relevant constituent groups and elected officials in matters that directly affect all community college students. Our pillars are our system participatory governance, our legislative and policy advocacy, and the regional support that we provide. I'd like to introduce our Vice President of Communications, Casey Chang, at this time.
Hello, everyone. I serve as a student trustee at the Mission West Valley or West Valley Mission School District in the Santa Clara, Saratoga area, so South Bay area. The SSCCC connection to SBAs is really important because, as President Tervalon said, we are the student voice for the community college system. So the SSCCC has 10 regions, 5 regional officers per region, which includes the regional affairs director, the legislative affairs director, the vice chair, treasurer, and communications officer. And dependent on which region you're in, if you're interested in a position, there are a couple openings dependent on the region. In addition, we have 116 college delegates when we have full activation. So every single college gets one important member to be their delegate to kind of advocate on behalf of their college. And they pretty much act as a conduit of information between the SBAs and the state. SBAs play a critical role in guiding our state level advocacy and priorities because delegates really help us know what's going on each campus and how can we help and what do we need to focus on or prioritize. So in addition, the SSCCC has connection to their student trustees. This includes pursuing legislation to empower student trustees, AB 1216, facilitating student trustee caucus, collaborates via region and state level, coordinating joint legislative visits, providing information and background materials, providing a voice for students on issues affecting students, and communicating issues of concern adopted by college delegates, and of course, outreach. So once again, there's a lot that the SSCCC does for and with student trustees, and we're here to just empower and kind of guide you as you begin your term. I'm going to go ahead and pass it off to, I'm going to go ahead and hand it back to President Tervelon. Or I'm going to pass it off to Rad 5 via Riel.
Alrighty. Hello, guys. Hello. I'm also a student trustee for the West Coast Community College District, and I also serve as the Associated Student Government President for my college campus. So once the slide turns, perfect. We'll get into what it is to be on an SBA board. And if you didn't know what an SBA means, it is a student body association. Now you hear it a lot in the SSCCC because that's the term that we like to use, but I know there's, you know, ASG or ASO, which is also known as, you know, an Associated Student Government Board or Associated Student Organization Board, but essentially they're all student boards. And for us, that little acronym is just an easier way that we can refer to the all general of student body associations. So working with SBAs, as a student trustee, it's very important to develop a good relationship with your own SBA boards, depending on if you have multiple colleges or just one campus. So developing a relationship, so when you call upon them, they show up. So as a student trustee, it's important to not only sit at these meetings, but be able to listen and hear to, you know, what your SBA boards are wanting to, or have their issues, what kind of issues that they are expressing and how you can help them on that district level. So one of the important things to do is hold regular meetings with SBA leaders. So with these SBA leaders, it's important to really be able to talk to them and have that constant updating. Now you can also hear local issues of concern and learn what students care about. As student trustees representing on that district level, it's important to hear what students care about and what their concerns are. So it's important to not only speak to those SBA leaders, but also speak to students and hear out those concerns. You can also use your SBA meetings to get support, and you may need them to take positions to support your stance. So if you have something that you're really passionate about and really care for and to advocate for students, it's important to also have that SBA leadership support you. And when you talk and develop that good relationship with your SBA boards, they'll be able to take that backing behind you. And like I said before, attend SBA meetings to hear from students and let them know you care about their issues. So just attending these meetings and even showing up shows that you're dedicated and shows that you're really wanting to advocate for students. Now bring issues to them. Ensure that they are part of the governments and college and participating on key governments committees. Now Title V, Ed Code 51023.7 says that we as students are able to serve on these governments committees. So instead of just it being all staff, we are able to have that say and have that voice heard from us once we serve in these different committees. We also need to gauge student concerns. Now, how can you do that? One of the most popular ways is to hold surveys. Now, I recommend 5-minute surveys that you send out to students. I know one of the main issues was how, as a student trustee, how am I able to represent the entire body of my students? So one of the biggest ways is to hold surveys, forms, and meetings and focus groups. So I know there's Google Forms out there. That's also a big part where you can just make one. It'll be simple. Ask general questions. Maybe what are some of your concerns? What are your suggestions? And what do you think we can do better? Or what can I do as a student trustee to really help you? And holding those meetings or focus groups is also essential, because by being open, I know it was talked about with if you attended the student trustee workshop, those office hours. Holding those office hours and being able to let students know, hey, I'm here for you, and really come and talk to me and bring me your issues is an important thing to do. Now, can we move on to the next slide? Perfect. Additionally, as a student trustee, you hold some responsibilities. Now, you have to, like before, use your position to get participatory on participatory governance groups. So when staff members hear that you're a student trustee, they know that you're holding that responsibility of advocating for students. Therefore, they know that you're really dedicated and really want to have that say heard. And so by using your own position and saying, hey, I'm the student trustee, I would like to serve on this committee, really shows that, you know, your voice is going to be heard in a different light compared to other students. But at the same time, students' voices need to be heard. Now, also as a student trustee, you work with some of our partners. You work with faculty, staff, and other board members. So it's important to also develop a relationship with them too. You know, even recognizing just faces or names is really important and shows that staff member or faculty that, hey, I have stuff to say and it's important. Now, one of the big things as a student trustee is to manage your time and workload. I know it can get very busy, especially being a full-time student and, you know, developing all this time into student advocacy. It becomes important to really manage your time and workload. So make sure you have a calendar or a schedule and a routine that's very important to just managing your time. Additionally, prepare for meetings. So when you hold these Board of Trustees meetings, read the agenda and, you know, have a little bit of notes, or even attending SBA meetings. Make sure you have those notes to report on at those SBA meetings and report on what the district is saying. Next, gather information. Just like I said, taking notes is an essential part of being a student trustee, because once you take those notes, you're able to really retain that information and show that, hey, you know, these are the highlights that I've gotten from it. Additionally, using your resources to identify issues. So once you have all this information and you have these kind of notes on your side, you're able to use those resources and identify those certain issues that are happening within your district. And with that, I would like to pass it back off to our president, Lamar Turbulon. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And our next reading will be coming up.
Hi, everyone. My name is Preet Kaur. I am a student trustee for the Contra Costa College Community District, and it is located in San Pablo. So it's in the Bay Area. So today we have a very exciting portion for you, which is the student panel. We have our presenters here today. I'm going to go ahead and ask them to unmute and introduce themselves. I can call on our RAD4, Robert Andrade, to go first.
All right. Thank you, RAD3. Can you guys hear me? Okay. Can you guys give me like a thumbs up? Y'all can hear me. That would be lovely. Sound check, period. Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Robert Andrade. I am the past student trustee for San Jose Evergreen Community College District. My pronouns are he, him, his. I just finished a major in law, public policy, and society, and I'm also working towards a second for child development. It's an honor to be here to discuss this important role that everyone shares and all the common goals that everyone here hopefully shares. And I'm excited to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I'll call on Viviana Patino.
So, Supreet, we're running a little early, and the other two panelists have not arrived yet. So we give it just a second. We're texting right now.
Okay.
And everyone in the audience, if you haven't had time yet to drop your information in the chat, please introduce yourself to the rest of the group by dropping the information in the chat.
Thank you all for bearing with us. I believe our panelists are arriving now, so we will begin the panel in just a few moments.
Okay, I see that Josh has made it. So Joshua, may you introduce yourself to everybody?
Hey, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Hi, I'm the student member on the California Community College Board of Governors, and I'm also the student trustee for Calbright College.
Thank you. Viviana, can you introduce yourself, please? Just having technical problems.
Okay, I think it was unlocked now because it just is that the host wouldn't let me, but I'm Viviana Patino. I'm the student trustee of Chabot Las Positas College. This is my second year as the Chabot Las Positas student trustee, and it's also my first year as the California Community College Board of Trustee.
Thank you. Okay. So we have a question for all of you. Why do you think it's important to gather student opinions to inform your actions on the board? Please share two strategies, effective outreach strategies.
I can go first if anyone else is ready. So one of the first things that one of the first issues that I kind of brought up with my board was kind of when people last year were going into in-person classes. However, like gas prices being extremely high, a lot of students were like telling their teachers, hey, like I can't come into class, like I don't have money for gas. And it wasn't just like one teacher, it was like multiple teachers across campus. But the thing is, I didn't only find out through like asking my students like, hey, like how are classes doing? I was also asking professors that were like part of the academic senate. And basically, like, it's how you can see, like, if teachers also talk about how it's a problem with their students and students are just talking with their students, you kind of are informed of one of the issues that are going around on campus. Therefore, that's how I was able to gather, like, their opinion, like, oh, should we offer more gas cards to students, which is how we kind of were asking for donations from Chevron. And that is one of the things we did for our campus last year. So I feel like just asking around like students on how, you know, coming into in-person classes are like, because some teachers either had hybrid options or just didn't have hybrid options at all. And that's how we came to like the conclusion of just having not only the basic emergency fund, but also just the gas cards. And then another thing we did, we would do polls after like certain events. Like we have like suicide prevention week, and we would carry like workshops with grief, with mental health and all this stuff like that. And after that entire week on campus, we would have a poll on like which workshops worked, which workshops didn't, which do you wish we had more of, how can we support you more, like do you need more counselors, do you need more options on like who to go to, where to go to. And from that, I also have asked our Dean of Academic Senate just how to, basically, we created like a whole new website to have all of the resources that you need. So right off the bat, from low income to the National Suicide Hotline, because of Roe v. Wade, we created like the National Abortion Finder, because even though it isn't illegal here in California, we want to make sure that, you know, people know that they still have options here. We are doing like the Trevor Project. We have like Asian American, like national hotlines, like every single hotline in a website at our school. So that's what we kind of started doing because of us asking students, like, what is something that you need that you're not receiving from us? And what do you not know about that you wish you did know about? So those are the two things that I've done on my campus.
Yeah, I would add on, I would say, you know, it's super important to gather student opinions when informing your actions, because as a student trustee, it's easy to be like, I'm in this role, I have my own opinions, I know what like makes a difference for me, but you're one of the thousands of students that are at your campus, and each one will have different unique needs. There's different populations of different backgrounds, both LGBTQ, racial, ability. There's so many different populations on campus that if all their voices need to be heard. And so when you're in this position, gathering their opinions makes it so you know what is important to them and how you can move forward to advocate for the things that you that would make a difference for them. Because on a board, you are the student voice. As a student trustee, you are responsible for all the populations of the college, not just students, but you are the only one who will be the voice for students on that on that board. So it's important to also know that you, if you don't share your opinions and other students' opinions and gather those, often there won't be another person who's doing that. I do hope that there's a cultural change in that and everyone's looking at students, but at the end of the day, gathering other student opinions is super important for you to be able to advocate for everyone's needs on campus.
Thank you, both of you, for your answers. I believe it's important to gather student information because my previous student trustee panelists had said, each campus has such a diverse group in it within itself, and to gather all those opinions and either gather all of those feedback and wants and needs can be extremely, you know, it can be extremely difficult at times. So besides, you know, because me personally, I pester my classmates all the time. So besides, you know, pestering classmates about like what's going on and what's happening, what's not, some strategies that I utilized that I felt were sort of advantageous was I had formed sort of some advisory groups regarding my own campuses within my role as student trustee. An advisory group is pretty much a group where we can have discussion and they can advise you know, we could advise what is happening, but at the end of the day, it falls on the student trustee who would be the chair, which would be me. So hearing different fallacies, who's not just an ASG or SBA, excuse me, hearing other individuals who are just not an SBA, because at the end of the day, everyone has a seat at SBAs, whether that's an advisory vote or not. Everyone, I feel like just gathering individuals or other students through these advisory groups is extremely advantageous. And it's not even just limited to students. You can have faculty and advisories, because at the end of the day, faculty and staff, they also have the best interest of the students at heart in the student body. And I feel like that's another way. SBAs is a student body association. It's just synonymous with associate student government or associate student organization. Thank you for asking that. So with that being said, sorry, I totally lost my train of thought, I apologize. But utilizing faculty and then staff as well as sort of another way to you get effective strategies, because at the end of the day, we are just one person, but at the end of the day, I contextualize and recognize that sort of professors and faculty, they have much more of a stronger gauge of what the students wants and needs. So hearing their perspectives as well and being willing to hear that and conveying that to the Board of Trustees, I think will be one of your toughest assets to me. Thank you.
And I would just add too, because I didn't really share the effective strategies in my first response. One of the ways that I really engaged students was just being on the ground. I know it's hard in the virtual world to engage students, especially if your campus is still having a lot of virtual participation, but we would at my campus host forums for those virtual students, so that way they could come and talk to us. And we had virtual office hours as a student trustee and also other members of our student government. But in person, one of the things we did at SMC, which I was at Santa Monica College for a time being, we had purchased merchandise. And so we would do like surveys and hand out merchandise at events and just on campus. So that way, like, we have hats and hoodies and stuff, and we would be able to engage and talk with the students hands-on about the things that matter to them. So just being personable as well, and just talking to them, sharing your experience, sharing your college story and journey is important. So that way they feel safe to share the things that concern them on campus as well.
One just quick note before we move on is I think last Monday I was at like my students' financial aid just to like check it out, because just because I haven't been to that part of campus yet, because I think most of my classes were online, and last year when I had classes in person they were in the afternoon, so it was closed. So I did go to like check it out, and I was seeing like there was a lot of people there at like a certain office like waiting around, and I was like going through to attend like my student senate meeting. And I had asked them like, oh, like, are you guys like waiting for something specific? And they had told me like, hey, like the advisor for this certain, the basic emergency fund or school had just quit, and they didn't know who to submit like the application forms or anything like that. And I was like, oh my God, like, I'm so sorry. Like, I'll go figure it out for you. And like, you let me know. And then like, I did like give them my information so I could let them know about it. But from there, like, I was like, and if you have like more problems, please reach out to me. Like, if there's like something that you feel like that needs to be done more, reach out to me. Or if you want to attend the student senate meeting where we have like public comments and you want to report something, the meeting is in like in 15 minutes every day this time, so you know, you can find me there too. And that's how I like how I react or reached out to like multiple students on my campus.
Definitely. Thank you all so much. So following on that, what is one issue that you have addressed as a student trustee? I'm sure you guys address like so many issues, but what's like an issue that you're very, very passionate about that you addressed?
That's a good one. I guess I'll go first. One issue that I addressed as student trustee was actually the mandation of the COVID vaccine policy. I feel like that one sort of was a big issue that sort of, and it was at towards the tail beginning of my term, so that pretty much set the precedent for the rest of my term. I feel like that was an issue that I felt really, you know, really good to be part of, because that, although it was very taxing and kind of at times very hard to navigate that, it was really, it really did show me my true role as student trustee and what my role and the severity of it is. In that my sole vote, or not my sole vote, excuse me, my sole role as student trustee on the district is to elicit that type of information. So eliciting that type of severe information where it was a split difference between, you know, for and against, I think that was probably my biggest issue that I addressed. Thank you.
Yeah, I addressed similar issues, and there was just so many things we did, but I think I'll touch on more of some equity things that I worked on. So our student trustee at our campus is not the same person as the student government president. So we do have those two roles are separate. I know that's not the same across the state, but for us, it was, and so I worked closely with the student government that year to be able to, and the Board of Trustees to support working with our meal project. So we have a food security program on campus, which offers either fresh meals to pick up to the students, or you can also, it's kind of like a partnership with Uber Eats. There's a it's called Bento is how we call it. And you can get meals from local restaurants up to a certain amount per month, and depending on the units that you're in and everything. So I worked closely with the campus student government, as well as the board. And I acted as a liaison between the two to be able to finance this program, to be able to continue throughout the pandemic. We did have some pandemic funds, but at the same time, it wasn't a guarantee that those would be used for this program. And so it ended up being that the student government funded half, and then the Board of Trustees and the president funded the other half. And it was a good way to both use the pandemic funds and help support students through a time that was very difficult on financials and everything throughout that period at the very beginning of the pandemic, but also to support food security and make it so that students could focus on their education and not worrying about food insecurity.
So the same thing as Joshua, the student trustee position and the student like Senate president position are completely separate. So I worked really closely with my student Senate on a lot of issues that we were kind of like trying to address. But I think like one of the more personal ones that I really liked last year was that we created a prayer room on our campus for students who, you know, are on campus more and they need to pray like specifically like maybe like five times a day, or even those who isn't necessarily praying, it's meditating or whatever their religion or cultural like calls it. And I think that one was like really cool, just because that's also something you typically see on campus, and our argument was for it was because, you know, we want to respect everyone, we want to give everyone the personal space to just, you know, have a moment to themselves, because, you know, you need it, whether or not like it's based off religion or your culture. It's just something we thought it was good to prioritize for our students. And I addressed it. I worked with the FIT committee, and it was, now it's like near like our building that has like all of like the mental health offices, which is really cool. And then from there, we also like created like wellness ambassadors, which is basically like how we have mental health counselors, but now we have like peer guides, like student peer wellness ambassadors, which is cool, because I think that even as much as you love to talk to like, you know, a professional adult who knows everything, sometimes it's good to talk to a college student who might be going through the same thing as you, who understands you in a way that like others may not understand you, because I know it's always better to like have a team by team connection. That was just one of the things that we accomplished last year.
Yeah, another thing I'd like to add too, besides like some of the more like critical basic needs things, we did also work on funding graduation caps and tassels and some gowns for students as well, to alleviate that financial burden on the students, specifically for the special support programs such as like Guardian Scholars, Next Up, EOPS, Adelante Black College, and some of the things that students that may not be able to afford those additional $50-$60 costs. So that was another thing that we worked with our as a student trustee, I worked on to be able to support the students and things that would actually make a difference to them and being able to enjoy graduation.
Definitely. So moving on, can you all share how to effectively use your advisory vote?
Yeah, I think one, I don't think we should have advisory votes. We should have full votes like I do on the Board of Governors. I think student trustees, there's no reason not to. So I definitely think that this group should look into continuing to advocate for getting a full vote. But in the meantime, as you have an advisory vote, I think it's important to get to know your trustees individually. I made it a point to really establish and cultivate relationships with each and every one of them, and to really just talk to them about my position outside of the meetings. Sometimes it's hard to voice your full opinion and have a conversation with them during a public meeting because there is a schedule, there's a time frame, there are things that you need to do during a meeting that don't necessarily allow for the full space to just have a dialogue fully, even though you can have some sort of dialogue. So just really building those relationships with them to have them understand the student perspective on certain issues can really hone in on having the advisory vote be something that's more and that is just very impactful. Another thing I would say too is that if you don't already vote first, and if you're comfortable requesting, have your board see if you can do your advisory vote first. I personally didn't have that because my board was very student forward. So I didn't request that because I just felt like I could be called in alphabetical order. But if you do have an advisory vote and it doesn't seem like your board often follows what the student population wants at your campus, I would request having your advisory vote go first. So that way it's known to the public that the student is voting this way and then the other people are not voting this way, if that is kind of the dynamic of your campus.
Just really quickly, I actually do not have an advisory vote on my campus. And it was actually, we had asked the campus, I think about 5 years ago or 5 to 8 years ago, I want to say. And the Board of Trustees that were there all said no. However, the chancellor I have now, we and him had been talking about it because right after the conference that we had in Sacramento in SF with all the student trustees, after that, me and my other student trustee in my community college, we were like, we want an advisory vote in our board meeting. Like, we made it very like straight off the bat, and then we had a board retreat. So we did let them know, like, by the way, we want an advisory vote. And I had a meeting with my chancellor and I had told him, like, what's the meaning of this? And basically what he had said, like, the former board was a very conservative board and they actually really didn't really respect the student trustee that was on there. So, and with my board, I haven't really had that issue. So me asking them, I wasn't even that afraid to, because they were pretty supportive. And then at a retreat, they were like, what we want to do is raise our student trustee's voice. So now that has been going on, I will probably, the next time I ever see you guys, I may have an advisory vote. But I do know that we have been making a plan on like how we want it to work, because if kind of like what Joshua said, like, you don't want just an advisory vote, you want a real vote, because then you can show that how much power you have as a student trustee, you are a voting member and everything like that. But I will let you guys know how it works once I receive one.
Thank you. Thank you to the both panelists who have just spoken. Okay. Thank you to both of the panelists who have just spoken. First of all, I apologize for putting period. I literally was typing that and I didn't realize I was doing it. But the reason why I'm such a big infringement on our big proponent on, you know, like my fellow panelists, student trustee Aloz Londo said, that I do believe that we should have full voting rights. I, last year, part of the student trustee caucus was part of a work plan and or no work group to sort of start getting student rights full votes initiative. Since then, it hasn't come to fruition, but, you know, the idea was there and I really was supporting it. I think even though we have an advisory vote, I think we all need to recognize and contextualize that as student trustees, we're the actual students and that we're the ones who are actually, you know, living through the policies that are being made or living through the decisions that are being made as students. So I feel like by making and explicitly letting that notion be known to your board of hearing like, hey, as a student trustee, I am eliciting this information as a student who is on the ground, you know, with these other students, I feel like by eliciting that, that would probably be the best way for your boards to, you know, peek the scene and, you know, make that switch of like, oh, you know, maybe we need to actually, you know, heed to what they have to say in order, because they're actually the ones who are on the ground. So that would probably be my one little, my notion of how to effectively use your advisory vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's important just to like speak up to the rest of the board as well, just because I remember during my, during our board meeting, I made a motion and I was recognized that I could not make a motion as student trustee. And I had brought that up during the retreat and had that changed, because it's important that the rest of the board doesn't just see you as like the student trustee, but actually as the rest of the board, you know, and they don't disclude you. So with that being said, what information do you consider to inform your decisions about board items?
Well, I think it's important, as I said in my response to the first question, to really understand the student perspective. So gauging how students feel about particular board items and how they would like you to vote. I also think as a student trustee, something that you touched on is that you're a full trustee. So it's important to also understand other constituent points of view as well, to be able to collectively make a decision on what you're doing. As a student trustee, again, you are the student voice because that is the nature of the role that you were elected into, but you also sometimes may vote either neutral or abstain or even against students, in the sense that it doesn't make sense for the district as a whole, because ultimately as a student trustee, the district is the first responsibility. And having students' voice heard in those decisions is really important. So for me, I always would review everything, talk to different constituents groups, as well as make sure that I clearly understand how students felt. And if I was going to vote in a different way than what students wanted, I always made sure that the student voice was at the table, either talking for themselves in a different capacity, such as like having the AS president or other student representatives, or sharing their opinion and then still voting the way that I felt best represented the district's liabilities.
Yeah, I would have to agree with Joshua. I had literally the same idea, just based off like student perspective, what you think would be best for them and like your community college. For the most part, when I receive like the board agenda, I have like my students sending me like the same day. So usually I review it in the morning. And then when we have like our Senate meeting, I review it with them and ask them for their opinions and what I personally think on it. We kind of do like a mini pros and cons without the official term, like, oh, this is good, but have you thought about this? But if you don't do this, and how about this, and what we actually think about it. And then for the most part, since I do not have an advisory vote, what I usually do is when the discussion is open, sometimes they do ask for my opinion, or sometimes I just completely be like, by the way, this is what I think. And I just let them know, like, this is a great idea. However, have you guys considered this? If not, what are you guys doing about the certain issue about the specific item that we're talking about? And they do take everything into like perspective. They do really love like hearing what I personally think, because that's kind of what, you know, what you're there for. Like, you have to tell them like what you think based off as a student, because who is it affecting, like us, the students? So that's what I kind of do.
Thank you, both of you. Obviously, like I agree with both Joshua and Viviana when they have said, obviously, you know, take account what everyone's saying. You know, attend participatory governance that are going on your campus, attend advisory groups, just hearing more information of what the campus's wants and needs are at that time. And then, you know, eliciting that and then taking it and thinking if that's really going to be the most advantageous for the student body. I think that was sort of the one big thing that I can really think of, because like I said, Joshua and Viviana sort of hit the head on the nail, or the nail on the head, when they've already answered. Thank you.
Thank you. So this is all the questions for me. I'm gonna give it to the audience. If you all have any questions, feel free to ask. Kenneth, go ahead.
Oh, hello, can y'all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. I will turn on my camera, but I'm rocking a business top, bed bottom, which means I'm like not wearing pants on camera. Sorry, guys. But my question is towards the advisory vote. And I'd say that initially I was on the boat of giving us an actual vote just as any other trustee, because you know, if we're going to be said that we're treated as equal and we're regarded as equal to other trustees, and in terms of governance, we should have the same power in terms of voting and such. But obviously that's not the case if we're given an advisory vote. But there's also the level of legal accountability. There's also responsibilities that we have towards the students and not necessarily the rest of the institution. And from, I guess, attending the student trustee workshop a couple weeks ago, there's a lot of heavy emphasis on students or student trustees to quote unquote stay in their place, which, I mean, there's good implications of that, but there's also, you know, if you're telling somebody to stay in their place, you know, like stay in line, don't do what you're not supposed to do, that's not necessarily like my flow, right? So as far as just giving students power, what are some of the, I guess, pros and cons in terms of getting a student a real vote in terms of governance rather than just an advisory vote?
I think I could speak on this because as a student trustee, I had an advisory vote when I was a student trustee at Santa Monica College. Now I have a full vote on the Board of Governors and a full vote on the Calibrate College. So I've seen the difference between the two, and really there's none in my experience so far. When our board has been implicated in some legal litigations, and there's never been any impact on me or follow through on me as the student member of the board based on decisions that have gone through the court. So I've never fully had anything really blow back on me. The only difference I would say really is that people start to begin to treat you a little differently. At Santa Monica, I never was treated differently than a full trustee, even though I had an advisory vote, but I know that's not the same on every campus. And so if you were to be given a full vote, it changes the dynamic of the board to understand like your voice is equally important. I'm not just like a trophy person on this board. I'm not just someone who is here to share an opinion, but you don't have to listen to me. If you have a full vote, you have a full vote, and your voice will be equal to those that are on there. One thing that I will say that I did work also on trying to get a full vote, and some of that work that had happened a couple years ago, and part of the, I don't want to say scare tactics, but the way that they were trying to get us not to continue was the legal liability part of it. And if you actually look into what you would be liable for and how the decisions would fall back on you, it's not that, it's not as scary as it's made out to be. And it's not exactly the reasons that people use to try to justify not doing it. So at a community college, you're balancing much lower budgets, much more intimate conversations within the district. I think if the California Community College Board of Governors, who navigates 116 colleges, an entire system of almost 2 million students, can have a full vote, there's no reason why any district should not be able to do the same thing. Legally and through legal consultants, there is no reason that the Chancellor's Office legal team could find that they're why we shouldn't do full votes. It was vetted multiple times from legal counsel, and it's more of just opposition of what it means for students to have a full vote and how it would impact the dynamics on campuses to be able to see that this is a community college system made up of students. Students are the clients. They should have a voice at the table, not just have their decisions made for them. Yeah, close. I see the comment. Closed sessions. That was another contention that people had talked about in the full vote part. Can students I always heard Kent students keep the secrets or keep their mouth shuts is kind of basically how it was worded. At the end of the day, I think it does require a student to understand the position. As it was mentioned, there is some liability, like you can't share what is going on with personnel issues and you can't share certain things. So as a student trustee that is allowed to have a full vote and allowed to be in closed session, there is more significance and more weight to that role. I think it's an opportunity for a student to grow in leadership and for a student to be able to understand how to be in these roles outside of being a student, because there are boards and opportunities that are beyond being a student member of a board. So being in closed session shows you the ins and outs of the position, not just also having an advisory vote.
Kenneth, go for it.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, you can hear me. Okay.
I guess somewhat of a follow-up question. My computer's acting up. Somewhat of a follow-up question as far as getting to know the role and how or where exactly you fit in governance, as far as not just like with the vote, whether it's advisory, full vote, or even being in closed sessions. How do you really engage with the board as far as getting things on the agenda or working with the agenda? Because from my experience, obviously you do have to kind of study the agenda and what the board is going to be talking about. But at least within my district, they usually post the agenda, a week, probably less than a week before the actual meeting. So there's not a lot of time to get a feel for what's going to be there. So there's a lot of running around and talking to people outside of the meetings in order to get this information that's available. So it creates this environment where the real decision making is happening outside of the meeting, but the finalization is happening within the meeting. So how do you navigate that kind of environment outside of board meetings in an effective way?
One thing that I've done and just in my board of trustees is basically in my report, I bring up the state of the issue. I straight up cold-heartedly just be like, by the way, this is my problem with the board. I'm a little feisty one sometimes, but I do bring up right then and there. I let them all know everything. I'm like, this is my issue. You guys didn't have to put the budget for this. You guys didn't do this and whatever, whatever. And I'm like, thank you so much. I love you guys, whatever. And right after, I do plan meetings with the chancellor and the president of the board. I plan them for right after. I talk to the secretary on speed dial. I need to know when they're available. I need to tell them about this. I need to tell them, because I will keep pestering. I need the board to talk about this. I need this to be this motion to be made. So I do kind of just, I laid it all out and then I talk to them until they can officially be like, okay, fine, we'll make a motion on this. We'll talk about it with the other board of trustees. And I will not let them go a week without emailing me back. I'll be like, well, what have you done? Because it's been a week and the board of trustees meeting is coming up very soon. So what is going on? How are we going along about this? Because if not, I will bring it up again. So I feel like just definitely being completely stern with your board and being like, this is something that we need to talk about, because I'm not saying that they will dismiss you, but they're just like, oh, they're just a student trustee. They really have nothing to offer me or give me. At least that's how I felt with my board, especially the first year. So now that they've seen that I am not a force to be reckoned with, they answer my emails and my phone calls.
Yeah, I really appreciate that approach to it, because as I've said, as a student trustee, you are a full trustee. And I really, for me, I also cultivated that relationship with my president and board chair. At Santa Monica, it's a little interesting. The board chair rotates once a year, so it kind of everything changes in the middle of the term. So still get used to all the other trustees and just talk to everyone because you never know when leadership might change if someone decides to leave or whatever. So it's always good to talk to everybody. But yeah, be fearless in your communications and just talk to the president of the college in particular, especially about the agenda. They're the board chair and the president are the ones who make the agenda typically for the meeting. So just I had monthly meetings scheduled with each of them, and I would always email them whenever something came up. And if they didn't have an answer, they would forward me to the vice chancellor or vice president that did have an answer. I think one thing I would just add before is just that as a student trustee, I like taking off the word student because you're a trustee. And technically the president of the college reports to you, or the chancellor of the college reports to you. You are their quote boss. I wouldn't necessarily say that to them directly, but it is the dynamic. And if another trustee reached out to them, they would respond right away. They would respond fully. And so you just have to make sure that they know that you're a trustee first and foremost, and then you just happen to be a student. So it's important to just kind of have that dynamic known, because I was also student government president a different year besides being a trustee. And then I did notice the dynamic change whenever I emailed. It would be like a couple days versus almost immediately. So just make sure that they know you're a trustee when you're messaging them, so that way that they get back to you.
No, period. Thank you for both of you. I appreciate the I'm always appreciating the intonation where, you know, student trustees actually, you know, we won the election and we got appointed. So we earned just as every right for them to be at that table than they do. So I would just like to elicit that as well. I did hear, I think it was a question, something on the lines of like most of the agenda or most of the planning happens outside the boardroom, and it low-key does. So a strategy that I utilized was, honestly, I went to just go have like coffee or lunch with other board members. Like, that was a low-key strategy of mine that helped, because by building those interpersonal one-on-one relationships with each of the board member, that was also, besides obviously, you know, being cordial and respectful, it allowed me that one-on-one time to explicitly express it, what the students want and need. And I utilized that time totally to, you know, pretty much to have a kiki and just discuss what really is needs and what's wanted. And then at the end of time, another notion would be making the board secretary your very good friend. Like, the board secretary knows where everything is at. They know where all, I don't want to say they know where the bodies are buried, but they would know where the bodies are buried. So I would really just like to elicit that you be your best friend to your board secretary, because to me, the minute I bought Miss Sherry, in my case, Miss Sherry, we went to go get Starbucks coffee, all of a sudden it was, you know, having that asset, you could just tell the difference. So that'd be my little nugget of addition. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Kenneth, go for it.
Hello. Okay, I'm sorry for taking up all these questions. I'm a very talkative person. So I guess you guys spoke a little bit on, I forget what the exact question was, but some of the work you guys did in your previous term. And as somebody who's trying to approach, I guess, more topical or controversial things, how would you approach a touchy topic? Because something that I'm trying to do in my district is I'm trying to have a, because I'm working with some people, trying to set up a series of discussions regarding public safety and how the community feels within all the colleges in my district. And it gets kind of difficult because I'm the trustee of Los Angeles Community College District. So we have 9 colleges and it spans all across the county. And obviously different parts of the counties have different communities and environments for people. And there are some people who are like, okay, we need to have security on campus who are armed and ready to shoot if necessary. Others may not be like that, right? So there's a very key approach in how people feel about safety. And especially when you're bringing in the people who have in some cases shot and killed students for different reasons in different situations. How would you go about approaching a discussion like that or setting up some kind of work to address that?
Those are definitely tough conversations. So I have a couple things that I would say. So one, I think if as a student trustee, it just really depends on the dynamic of your district. But as I've said, you're a fully fledged trustee. And so I would definitely just not be afraid to have those conversations, because other trustees wouldn't be afraid to have conversations that they're passionate about to things that are important for them. I think one way to not like blindside the board if it's something that the board isn't necessarily talking about would be to talk to the president and of the college or the chancellor, if that's how the role is called, when the president of the board, to just like let them know this is something that you're interested the board take up in conversation. Because I'm on the California Community College Board of Governors, I also know that each district should be having these conversations coming up. We just passed a community policing reform policy that all colleges will have to have mandated training for their police officers. So there is going to be these conversations happening on campuses, if not already starting to happen. So you should also come into the conversation knowledgeable about what is going on. And I can share that link to you if you weren't aware of that policy that we just passed as a Board of Governors. So it definitely, like, knowing what is coming to the college and what they are mandated to do will help in the conversation to help navigate what is best for your students on campus.
Yeah, I would have to agree with Joshua once again. Usually what I have done with topics that I feel like are pretty hard to bring up, I usually just have like a mini Zoom call meeting with my chancellor. And then from there, like, we talk about which way should I approach it, if there's any rewording that I should do to make it more like accessible and everything like that. And that's kind of how I've always brought up like difficult topics. But you know, you are like a full board member. You are just informing them of a certain issue that is going on, which is particularly like your job. Like, you are supposed to tell them about all the hard things that are going on, about all of like the tragedies, all of the struggles that the students in your community colleges are going through. So if that's like obviously a big passionate issue, that's something you should clearly bring up.
Thank you. Rod 5, go for it.
Sorry. Can you guys hear me? Okay, period. Sorry, my laptop's just being funky right now. Did I just cut someone off? I'm sorry, Air. I'm sorry,
no, Rod 5. Go for it. You're sorry.
My Wi-Fi just caught up to the conversation. My bad. Oh my goodness. I feel really bad. Just to elicit the same thing, having those one-on-one meetings with chancellor and president's office, obviously that's just so they can elicit that, or you can elicit that this is a need for the school and that you think it's the best for them. And then hopefully that they'll provide support in that. The one other thing that I would like to elicit is just having your associate student body or your associate student government also sort of have that support as well, because I know at the end of the day, if the ASG is the officials, although we're the official student voice on the Board of Trustees, they're considered the voice of the student body within the campus, of that particular campus. So I elicit by just getting that little, you know, extra layer of, I don't want to say, of support, because I feel like if it's an important conversation or not, I feel like whether the support or not, I feel like you should still do it. But just having that extra layer of just support, I feel like would be just probably that'd be the best way to go about it for me. Thank you. And I'm so sorry for cutting you off. I'm Rat 3 and Rat 5.
You're completely good. I know Supreet already called on me, so I'll just go with my question. I know there's a lot of, you know, when you're voting, a lot of representation behind you. So my question to the panelist was, I know it was a question also asked at our workshop, but when put in this position, you know, how do you represent your whole kind of student body, or just students in general. Like, you know, there's student trustees that represent 55,000 students, and it's not feasible to go to each one of them and say, how would you vote on this? So how do you take in that representation and vote on behalf of all the students that you represent?
I think that sometimes you can try different methods based off the campus. I know, like, a thing that I had talked about with my campus is that we have like a newsletter that comes out like every week. And in that newsletter, we talk about things that are going on kind of just on campus when things are going on. And I had asked them what if we had included, you know, what's going on in our board meetings, just because, you know, students, like when the COVID mask mandate was going on and off, students had like zero idea why and how that even happened. And I was kind of informing like them, like, oh, it's because the board members had voted on it. But I felt like no one really knew what even like the board members were and what they were doing. So I was like, why don't you include like it in the newsletter? And then like possibly ask students like if they feel okay with it or not. Or even just sometimes in different, like, we invite like a lot of students to our student senate meetings when it becomes super like important for students to know that there's a change on campus. So that's what we do as well. But I feel like it truly depends on the campus, because I feel like my campus is really small. It's only like 13,000 students.
So for Santa Monica College, our campus is much larger. We have about 30,000 students active, and then depending on the semester, a portion of that. So there's definitely a lot of voices and a lot of people to engage. I don't know if there's one way to engage them all, but one way that kind of worked for us as well was working with the administration to be able to use some of their campus-wide email blasting, especially because things were virtual and that structure hadn't been there in the past. Previous to the pandemic, student government could not send emails to everyone on campus. And I think we worked closely with being able to do that and set up a way where admissions had like a MailChimp or an email blast that would go out to everybody, where we could include surveys for the student government to engage their opinions. That way we could touch about more students than had previously been able to talk to, especially because virtual, no one was able to just get that opinion in person. I think one thing that came from that conversation also too was that we realized the institutional research surveys were going to spam because it was in our college spam filter. And when we were able to realize that, because we were engaging students and more involved in that process, the college was able to take off institutional research from the spam filter. And then they, instead of getting 200 responses to a survey, they ended up getting over 2,000. And so it definitely helps engage more of a larger part of the student population. But I don't think there is one particular way that will be able to engage more students, because everybody's different. Some students don't use their email. Some students live on their email, like myself. Some students do better text. So with our AGS or SGA, however the acronyms are, for different colleges, we also set up like a texting thing. So if people wanted to be updated through our text services, we were able to do it that way as well. So there's a lot of different ways to engage students, but knowing that the student population is diverse and there's different ways to reach out to them, and knowing that you have to pretty much do all of them to reach a wide section of the population.
Thank you so much. Steven, do you want to go ahead?
Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you so much, Director Kaur. Hello, everybody. My name is Steven Tadur. I was actually, I'm the community organizer for the Student Senate right now, and I was a student trustee about 3 years ago. And I do want to give a little bit of background. You heard about Assembly Bill 1216 earlier, so I want to give a background on that. But if I can address the question also that was just asked, I was a student trustee for a multi-college district, which means I sat on the Board of Trustees as the one student member that represented four different colleges, just like LA College District is, you know, nine different colleges, and two different centers. And you have to represent not just the, you know, the opinions and the perspective of your college. You're supposed to represent all of the colleges, and that makes it even much more diverse, right? So, you know, as some of the other student trustees were saying, one of the best things to do is not do all the work yourself. So one of the best things to do is, yeah, go to your student governments that are on each of those campuses, talk to them, but then have them turn around and talk to the other students. Go to your inner club councils. So that way you're talking to the club presidents, you know, of each of the different clubs, and then have them turn around and go to their club members, right? And then that way your reach is not just who you speak to, but who those other students speak to, and have them come back to you. Because there are going to be some contentious issues that pop up on your campus. And there's going to be issues that you want more than just your own perspective or the perspective that comes from your, you know, eight member student government that you have. So make sure that you have other students that are working for you, and your reach is extended exponentially to reach so many more students. You know, have them engage in those conversations for you on the ground with those other students, because, you know, you'll be able to reach so many more and have much more of a diverse perspective going into that board meeting. So I guess, you know, that would be from experience, what I would do, especially in a multi-college district. We started what we called a STAC meeting, a Student Trustee Advisory Committee, and we kind of convened the presidents from each of the community college campuses, and we met before the board meeting every time just to go over some of the agenda items, go over some of the issues that we're going to reach the students eventually, and talk about, you know, what unified student perspective that we were going to bring to that meeting. So that would be my recommendation. But as I said, I was a student trustee a couple years ago, and myself, along with some other student trustees at the time, we you know, got behind Assembly Bill 1216. And what we tried to do is accomplish three things during that Assembly Bill. One was to get the student trustees a full vote on each of the boards. We wanted to get student trustees just compensation, meaning if they are sitting on that board and they are recognized as full members, why are they not receiving compensation like all of the other board members? And the third one was for them to attend closed session. So those are the three things that we sought out to accomplish. And once we hit the floor with this bill, it was amended quite a few times. And we received a lot of opposition. So one, on the full vote, a lot of the opponents, and especially one of our main opponents was the League, right? The Community College League of California, which is the organization that runs the student or runs the trustees and CEOs of the board. They've coined this phrase local control. And that's what they're preaching is local control, meaning every district should have the authority to choose what they do. I mean, each district's going to be different. So we don't want, what they're saying is they don't want, you know, things to come from the very top that are going to blanket to every district and tell them that this is how you're supposed to conduct yourselves. They want local control so every governing board can be different. So when it came to full votes, they're saying, we're not opposed to full votes, but why don't you give the districts the opportunity to be able to choose whether or not they want to give their student trustee a full vote. So that means you as student trustees should be able to advocate because your district has the authority to give you a full vote. Now, the other part of that is they argue that the board members that sit on the Board of Trustees are voted on at large, meaning they are voted on because of the district in which they live. Student trustees are voted on by their students. And for that to be the case, that means the students actually get to vote twice. And this is their reasoning. You, because you live in a certain district, get to vote for a district trustee who is your trustee that represents you, but then you also get to vote for your student trustee. And they also said that the elections for student trustees, the turnout is not the same as it is for Board of Trustees. But, you know, we can go there and say that, you know, the Board of Trustees voting, it's very minimal compared to the other voting that happens in their districts. But those were their main concerns when it came to giving student trustees a full vote. So when they amended it, they said, okay, every student trustee should have an advisory vote. Let's agree upon that and then give the local control forward to each of the districts to provide you know, the full vote if they would like. So you need to be the advocates for change on each of your districts saying, hey, you know what? We want this full vote, or we want this advisory vote, and this is how we're gonna do it. The compensation wasn't that big of an issue. Their concern more was, where's the money gonna come from? So in the bill, they had amended it to say that the money was gonna come from the state. So, you know, that was an issue. I mean, this bill ended up dying, right? But this is the give and take that we had during that time. And then closed session. And closed session was a contentious issue because of personnel, union negotiations, those kinds of things, because there's certain things that they believe that students should not be privy to. And so that was their argument there. What my recommendation to you all is, and I'm going to talk about this in I'm going to give a presentation in a few minutes on some of this, but my recommendation to you all is just check out your board policy and your administrative regulation that pertains to you, the student trustee, and see where you can implement change into that policy to make sure you get that advisory vote, to make sure that you get that compensation, and to have that go out and make sure that your students are behind that. So introduce that change into that policy and see if that works within your local control, because that's where the governing boards will say they have local control, is in that board policy, in that administrative regulation. So move forward that way. I'll speak to it a little bit more in my presentation later, but that was what I had to say. Thank you. Awesome. Thank you so much, President Turvalon. I'm going to hop right in. Because if any of you have had a training with me before, you know I like to go long. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit today about participatory governance. What is it? How do you effectively serve in it as a student trustee? Our 9+1 rights, what are we given by law to engage in conversations in? And really, what is that effect on the student trustees in general? So next slide. Perfect. So what is participatory governance? I like to throw this slide in here because there's four different colleges that are in here, and they all define participatory governance differently. You know, it's to facilitate discussions with different groups. It's a collaborative effort of all of the participants. It's a method of college management. But really, if you look at all the definitions, everyone defines it differently, but the base definition is when all the affected constituent groups are involved in the decision-making process. So when I talk about constituent groups, that is, you know, you as a student trustee, your constituents are your students. For the academic senate, it's the faculty. For the classified senate, it's the staff, you know, the janitors, the administrative professionals. And then for administration, it's the deans, the president. You know, those are their constituents. So when all of us, all of our affected constituent groups are getting together into that decision-making process, that is participatory governance. Us representing our prospective constituents and really providing that perspective in a committee meeting, in a task force, whatever it is, that is participatory governance. So we really want to make sure that we are representing our constituents, our students, to the best of our ability. Next slide, please. So what does the law say? So if we go to education code is a collection of the laws that directly relate to public schools. So anytime a law is passed and it relates to how a public school is supposed to operate, it is thrown into education code. An education code can only be changed by either the governor or the legislature. So there's two education codes that I want to go over real quick. 176060, it says the governing board of a community college district may authorize the students of a college to organize a student body association. The association shall encourage students to participate in the governance of the college and may conduct any activities as may be approved by the appropriate college officials. So this is saying that the authority of a college is the governing board, right? That board of trustees, and they authorize a student group, which we call the student body association, to represent the students and to participate in governance. So you are there as a student government to participate in the governance of the college. And your ultimate authority is the board of trustees, not your advisor, not the college president, not anybody else, but the board of trustees, because they are the ones that give you that authority. And they can pull that authority from your organization, but they still have to recognize students in the governance process. So there's been times in the past where a district will say, no, we don't recognize the student government anymore. Why? What's the reasoning there? And the SSCCC has had to come in and say, hey, you know, you need to recognize the students in the governance process. Students need to be involved. Why are we not recognizing students during this time? Why are we taking out this perspective? And that's all part of education code. And then 76061 just kind of shows the requirements to serve. You must be enrolled in at least 5 semester units, maintain the minimum standards of scholarship established by the district. We know that because you had to fulfill those requirements to serve as a student trustee, right? So go on to the next slide. So also in education code, it talks about what the college and the districts must do. Go ahead, next slide. So the state and local education code 70901 and 70902 says that the Board of Governors, which is the Board of Trustees with Trustee Elizondo Ciclan right now, the Board of Trustees for all California community colleges, shall establish minimum standards, and the local governing boards, which are the boards that you sit on, shall establish procedures that are not inconsistent with those standards to ensure ensure two things. One, that faculty, staff, and students have the right to participate effectively in district and college governance, and that the right of academic senates assume primary responsibility for making recommendations in the areas of curriculum and academic standards. So the Board of Governors says you must have these minimum standards, and your local governing boards have to have policies and procedures that say how you are going to uphold these standards. And the main one that we want to look at is for students to participate effectively in the district and college governance. How do we do that, and what does it look like? So let's talk about what those minimum standards are. Next slide, please. All right, so these are the 4 minimum conditions that the local governing boards have to have in policy. And I urge you to check out your policies and procedures that are on your campus that relate to these, and make sure that these are addressed in your policies and procedures. Most of you run off of board docs. It's going to be in your board docs. There's a list of all of these administrative regulations, board policies that will address these. So first, the opportunity to participate in the formulation and development of district and college policies and procedures that have or will have a significant effect on students, including those policies and procedures that outline it. So students must have, because these are the minimum conditions, they must have the opportunity to participate in the development of policies and procedures that have a significant effect on them. So any policy or procedure that's coming forward that's going to affect students must be consulted. They must participate in the discussion of that policy and procedure. If they are not, your college and your district is operating illegally. So if there is a policy or procedure that's coming forward and it's going to impact students, and students weren't consulted or students weren't a part of that process, that's illegal. You can't be doing that. And you have to be involved in the policies and procedures that outline how you are involved in that process. Is it just through your student government, or is it the fact that you're sitting on the different committees that are in the participatory governance specter, right? The second minimum condition is that, except in unforeseeable emergency situations, the governing board, your board of trustees, cannot take action on a matter having a significant effect on students until it has provided students with an opportunity to participate in the formulation of that policy and procedure or the joint development of recommendations regarding the action. So your board of trustees cannot take action on anything nothing that hits that board can be acted upon unless the students were consulted about it, unless the students participated in that conversation. I've serving as a student trustee in the past, there was a time where there was an action that was going to go before the board. Action was going to be taken, and I hadn't seen it. Our student trustee actually sits on the student government, and the student government didn't see it. And we asked, hey, you know, students didn't see this. What's going on here? And they said, well, it happened in committee and there was no student there. Well, that doesn't matter, right? Because if it's going to be acted upon and it's going to have a significant effect on students, they cannot take action until it's provided the students that opportunity. They didn't reach out to us and say, hey, we're having this conversation, you should be involved, right? Even though the committee existed, they needed to reach out to us and say, hey, this is the opportunity for you to take part in this conversation. This is where it's going to happen. All right, so you need to make sure that opportunity is afforded to each and every one of you and to your students. The governing board, number three, their procedures shall ensure that at the district and the college levels, recommendations and positions developed by students are given every reasonable consideration. I love this phrasing because it really says that you can't count us out as students and discount what we have to say because we are students. If we are making a recommendation on a policy, we say, hey, you know what? The students would love to see this added. And they just say, no, that we're not going to deal with that. You know, there's different ways to do this. No, the students are supposed to be given every reasonable consideration to formulate new policies, to recommend changes to policies. So as I was talking to you earlier about checking your administrative regulations or your board policies that concerns student trustees, look at those and see if you can actually put a recommendation in there to change that to better suit students, right? Because they need to give you as every reasonable consideration. You can introduce that into the constituency review process, meaning you can vote on that as a student government and then pass that on to another committee and say, hey, this is our recommendation for a change in this policy. And send that out through policy review and send that out to your different committees to make sure that they are giving the students every reasonable consideration. Hey, the students are putting this forward. Let's talk about this. That should be happening at every single college. And a lot of times what I see at colleges is the students wait for those policies and the recommendations to come from other committees and they just weigh in instead of actually being proactive and saying, no, this is the recommendations that we have. Let's look at this policy from a student lens and from a student perspective, and let's put in, you know, these specific recommendations and push that forward and push the student agenda onto the other committees instead of having them push their agenda on us and us just kind of saying, okay, we agree with this. And the last one says the governing board shall recognize the student body association as the representative body of students to offer opinions and to make recommendations to the administration and to the board. So they're saying that the SBA is the voice of the students and they are the ones that are representing the students. And all appointments to any committee are made by the student body association. So that means that if there's a committee on campus that needs to function because they need a student, they cannot just go out and grab any kid that's with a backpack and say, hey, come sit in this committee and have them just sit there and they have no idea what they're doing. They need to reach out to the student body association. The student body association is the one that puts their student, their representative into that realm, into that sphere, and into that arena to be able to represent the students effectively. So your college needs to have these minimum conditions in their board policies, in their procedures, in the way that they operate as a college to make sure that students are being represented. So make sure that you're being given every reasonable consideration. Make sure that your college and your student government is getting all the appointments to all the participatory governance committees. Make sure that all of that is happening on your campus. Next. Perfect, thank you. So what does that mean specifically for student trustees? First off, Student trustees sit on their governing board, right? You sit on the Board of Trustees, which is the only authority that is over a student government. So your job as a student trustee is, one, make sure the student voice is prioritized. You are that lone student perspective that's on there. You know, some of the other trustees might say, well, when I was a student, no, you are the student as a student trustee. Give that perspective and own that perspective. Make sure you're speaking up. Don't be the token student that just sits there. Don't be the fly on the wall, but make sure that you are there as the student perspective and the student representative to represent that voice on that board. You are going to go over board policies. You're going to go over things that task force have worked on. Make sure that students were involved in that process. Speak up and say, hey, was the student involved in this process? What were some of the things that the students said? And what were some of the maybe recommendations that students made? Were those given every reasonable consideration? And are they seen in this policy? Are they seen in this recommendation that's being brought to the board today? One, read the agenda and be prepared, right? A lot of times student trustees go into a board meeting and they're seeing something for the first time. That shouldn't be the case. That's why Brown Act exists, that you have the 72 hours in advance. Overview or review those policies, go over the potentially contentious issues with your student governments, with your college representatives, your student representatives, your ASG presidents, whoever it is, go over those contentious issues and formulate a unified student perspective that you will bring to the board. And speak out. Make sure that you are saying exactly what the students are feeling at those board meetings. Make sure that you're the last line of defense, right? The colleges, the student governments might be involved in the participatory governance committees, and they're trying to give their perspective in those meetings and say, hey, these are the things that the students want. But you as the student trustee are that last line of defense. You're the final stop for policies and procedures. So you need to make sure that you are weighing in all of the student voice right there. Hey, you are the last person that's going to be able to see this when it goes to that second read before it becomes an adopted policy. So make sure that you are the one weighing in the most at the very end, and making sure that if the students didn't get that right when they were in those governance committees, that it's brought forward at that board meeting and it's called out. So you need to ensure that the proper route was taken. Make sure, as I said earlier, that you speak up. Hey, the students weren't afforded the opportunity to be a part of this conversation. Let's make sure that this goes back out to the students before we weigh in. That happened. There was our district was trying to pass a health fee and it hadn't gone out to the students yet, and they were going to vote on it already. I spoke out. That health fee increase ended up being delayed, and they had to go back out to all the student governments and make sure the student governments were on board before that came back to the board. Speak up and speak out. Was the proper route taken? Were students consulted? Were they given every reasonable consideration in giving recommendations to whatever was going to happen? Make sure that's happening, that you are that final voice. And coordinate with the student body associations. Make sure the student voice is still being given that every reasonable consideration. So you play such a crucial role in student governance, right? Because you are on that board, the final stop, the highest authority for your college or your colleges, right? So make sure that your voice is being amplified. Next slide, please. All right, so the 9+1 ranks. It talks in the minimum conditions that we need to be afforded opportunities to be in the conversation for anything that might have a significant effect on students. So the law goes back in and education code says, okay, these are the 9 things that are going to have a significant effect on students. So the first one that will have a significant effect on students is grading policies. Obviously, the grading options that are offered in the classrooms and on your campuses is going to have a significant effect on you. Whether or not it's a policy on dropping the lowest grade, whether or not whether a class offers credit or non credit or the ABC system, or if your college has a policy that says we do pluses and minuses, maybe your college is only ABC, no plus or minus. You are involved, or you should be involved and the conversations around the policies and procedures that govern grading policies. That's the first one that has a significant effect on students. If there's a conversation going on about grading policies and a student is not in there, that is not operating as the law says it should. Number two is codes of student conduct. Ask to review them. Everyone has, every campus has a code of student conduct, how you were supposed to conduct yourselves as students while you were on campus. Go back in and review them. You know, the students had asked a couple years back to start doing in our conducts, our code of conducts is start having culturally sensitive trainings for students, and to make sure that that was part of our student conduct, that we were supposed to behave ourselves in a certain way. So make sure that that is in these codes of student conduct, right? Our the way that we present ourselves on each of those campuses. So make sure that that is being brought out. Number three was academic disciplinary policies. So the violations for plagiarism, cheating, any of those policies, if there's a conversation about that policy, you should be in the conversation. Also, did you know that students are given the opportunity to participate in the college review of cheating and plagiarism policies and the review of students that actually violate them? You are allowed to sit on the panels that review those. So any cheating or plagiarism policy, barring any conflict of interest, there should be a student on that panel also reviewing all of those, the violations of those cheating and plagiarism policies. Next slide. So number four, curriculum development. So your local curriculum committees are usually housed in your academic senate, but you must be involved in the policies and procedures that govern how the curriculum is chosen. So there's policies and procedures in your district that say this is how you choose curriculum for each of your classes. You as students need to be involved in the making and the recommendations and changes of those policies. So that's how you have a stamp and you have your hand on curriculum that's being chosen. You can be involved in that process. Number five, courses or programs that should be initiated or discontinued. This isn't a single class like your economics on Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 9 o'clock, they want to discontinue that. No, it's saying if you were going to take away your film class and not offer film at your college anymore, you need to be involved in that conversation. So it's the course or the program cancellation. Right now, a big thing that's going forward is our ethnic studies departments, right? Our ethnic studies is now going to be a requirement for our general education. And a lot of colleges are putting in ethnic studies departments. Are you involved in that process? If you're not, you should be. Legally, you need to be involved in the initiation of a new department on your campus. What is that ethnic studies department going to look like? What classes are going to be offered? You should be involved in that conversation and in the policies and procedures that are going to govern that department. Processes for institutional planning and budget development. So this is your local budget planning committees. One of the things that we say is get your local treasurers involved from your student government, but your college develops a budget. Make sure you're looking over that budget and allocating funds where they need to go. One of the things that we tried to do at our college is look at, we got all this HERF funding and the college started divvying out HERF funding, right? The COVID funding. And they started divvying it out where they thought that it was necessary. And us as a student government and myself as student trustee said, hey, wait, were the students consulted in this process? Were the students actually asked, hey, where do the students need the money to go? Because right now we have a food pantry that's bare and we have a lot of students that are choosing not to come back to campus because they don't have the resources necessary to do that. Why can't we use some of that funding to stock our food pantry? And you know, after they involved us in that process, boom, our food pantry was now stocked for our students. Make sure that you are involved in that budget planning and in your strategic planning. Where is your college going to be in the next couple of years, right? Make sure that you as students are leaving your footprint on your college's direction over the next couple of years in that strategic planning. Standards and policies regarding student preparation and success. You have a whole department on student success. There's policies and procedures that govern student success. Make sure that you are in the conversations there. Student services, planning and development, that's counseling, assessments, orientation. Are you helping in the discussion of what your new student orientation looks like? You as students should know, what are some of the things that I didn't receive as a new student that some of these new students could get that would help them be successful when they step foot on our campus? Be involved in that conversation. Student fees within the authority of the district to adopt. There are certain fees that you can levy on students as a governing board. Student activities fees, parking fees, health fees, all of those sorts of fees. Make sure you're involved in that. So those are the 9 things that the law says are going to have a significant effect on students. These things will impact students. They must be involved in that conversation. But then there's a plus one. So go on to the next slide, please. And the plus one says this: and any other district or college policy, procedure, or related matter that the district governing board, AKA the Board of Trustees, the board that you sit on as student trustees, determines will have a significant effect on students. So it's important to note that if a student can articulate its relevance to the effect on students, if you as students can say, hey, you're not consulting students in this area, yes, it's not a part of our 9 rights explicitly, but I deem that this is going to have a significant impact on me. And if we can argue that, then you can be involved in almost every decision-making process at their college. Any decision that's coming forward will probably have an impact on you. And you can argue that it will have a significant impact. All you have to do is argue that case, and you as student trustees sit on that board, and it's really your voice that they're going to be listening to. Yes, this is going to have a significant impact on students because I just heard the argument that our student trustee just had. Next slide, please. So if you look at this, on the left-hand side, these are our 9+1 rights. On the right-hand side, these are the faculty 10+1 rights. And if you look at your governing committees that are on your campus, these are some of the big ones, the 3 big ones: curriculum, your college governance, which is usually like college council or your communications council, and then the planning and operational committees. You can see with the arrows where your rights are being looked at as far as in those committees. So you need to make sure as a student trustee that you are connecting with that student government to make sure that they have students that are sitting in those committees, or you're sitting there yourselves. Because if we don't have a student in one of these committees, we're missing out on the policies and procedures that speak to some of our rights, right? Those conversations that we're supposed to be in, we are missing out on because we as the students aren't in that sphere. We need to make sure that we are there. So you can see a lot of these spots, some of them even overlap, but they're being heard in a lot of these different committees. And then they have that final stop at your Board of Trustees, because those policies and procedures make their way through these committees. And then those recommendations go to the Board of Trustees, and that's what you vote on, right? That's what the Board of Trustees votes on. So that's the final stop, and that's where you have that final say. So make sure you're plugging in with your student government and your student leaders that are in these committees. Make sure that their voice was given every reasonable consideration. And if it wasn't, you bring that voice back again. And if it was, you still bring that voice back to the Board of Trustees. Next slide, please. I think it's one of my last slides. So what does that mean for you? 1, student trustees should ensure that all participatory governance committees are filled. You sit on the biggest participatory governance committee, right? The Board of Trustees, you are there. The board is that governing board, but all of those committees that meet on each of those campuses, you need to make sure that your students are plugging in students there. Now, it doesn't have to be student leaders, but the student government, because of education code, gets to make those appointments. They can grab other students and put them there, but you need to make sure that the student perspective is being heard, training those students, making sure that they are giving that unified student perspective in those meetings, and really providing the best student perspective to those committees. And they're not just being a fly on the wall, right? That they are actually involved in that conversation. 2, anytime that a board determines that student input was not necessary, you should be the loudest voice in the room, arguing in support of the students, right? Like I said, you are that last line of defense. Do not let a board say that, no, we don't need student input here. That should never be the case. Anything that happens on a campus is going to have an impact on students. So argue that student perspective always needs to be given every reasonable consideration, needs to be given that thought, right? They need to take into consideration what we as students say. 3, rally students to speak on issues. Trustees love to see their involvement and hear their stories. I don't know how many times that a student came in and gave public comment, and after the meeting was over, a trustee went over to talk to that student, because the trustees love to hear what that personal experience and that personal perspective of students are. So when you do have a contentious issue, make sure that your students are there to support it or to rally against it, whatever that is. So, you know, send out those emails, send out those memos, send out those tweets, get students to your meetings to speak on the different issues that are going to be hitting that board. And last, relay important issues to the students so they're well-informed. We were talking about this in the panel earlier, right? How can we get the best feedback to our students? Making sure that we are talking to our student body associations, our clubs, you know, our different student groups and departments that are on campus, and making sure that voice is getting out there. We want to make sure that students are staying informed about issues that are either going to be voted on or have already been voted on and they need to know about. So we want to make sure that's happening. So you as student trustees play such a crucial role on your campus, especially in the governance process. So make sure that your students are getting the best bang for their buck, that you're really providing that best student perspective for them on the board, and that they are representing you on the campus. So last slide, I think, is just some questions and answers. If you have any questions, I think we got about 1 or 2 more minutes. But yeah, and I think I'll turn it back over to President Turbolo.
Sorry, I was muted. Thank you, Stephen. Wonderful presentation. I believe our next panelists have arrived. There's a question on the presentation and the slides. Yes, the presentation is being recorded, as was stated earlier, and will be available on the SSCCC YouTube website. And I believe we can make a copy of the presentation, so we can make those available for you as well. I'm not seeing any other hands or questions at this time, so I'd like to bring on our next panelist for our Board Trustees Effective Advocacy session. And at this time, I welcome Nazrin Johnson, Board President of State Center Community College District, Andy Lee, Trustee at Contra College, Community College District, and Hildegard, excuse me if I don't pronounce his name right, Acanaldo, with the California Community College's Board of Governors member. Thank you all for being here today. And our facilitator. Thank you.
Sorry, can everyone hear me? Okay. Thumbs up, thumbs down. Beautiful, fabulous. Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you to the board members who decided to come speak into this important panel for me. I'd like to take a moment for you guys to sort of introduce yourselves, if that's okay. I guess I'll start with, whoever wants to start first, I'll let you guys decide.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead. Just Andy, you want to go first, please?
Okay, I can go first. And good afternoon, everyone. My name is Andy Lee. I'm the Contra Costa Community College District Governing Board. And I was elected back in 2018 and served as a president last year. And I'm also the president of the Civic Leadership USA, which give out funding for the nonprofit organization. And also I'm the president of the API Coalition. We are building the coalition among the API elected officials. And so that's pretty much about me.
Thank you for that. I'll pass it off to Trustee Nazarene Johnson. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for the invitation to come and speak today. My name is Nazarene Johnson. I'm the board president for State Center Community College District. I was elected in November of 2020. So this is my almost second year. And I think our student voice is really important. And so I'm really glad to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. And last but not least, Trustee Hilde. I'm going to butcher this. I apologize.
Aguinaldo, you got it. It was right on the tip of your tongue. Well, first, thank you to FSCCC for having this dialogue. This is one of my favorite subjects to speak on. So I'm just so glad to be in this room with all the distinguished students and with my panelists today. So thank you very much. My name is Hilde Aguinaldo. I am appointed by then Governor Brown to the California Community Colleges Board of Governors, where I've sat for about 4.5 years now. And it's a pleasure to be serving as a public board member in that capacity. My day-to-day job is as an attorney working for a healthcare company and as a mom to a very rambunctious 4-year-old. So happy to be here. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much to the panelists. Next slide, please. Thank you. So first question, please describe what you see as effective advocacy by student trustees. I'll start with Trustee Johnson, please.
Thank you. Effective advocacy by the student trustees. I appreciate when students are involved. I know board meetings can be a little intimidating for folks that haven't participated or seen them. I know they were for me. So I speak from experience there. But I think it's really important to, you know, review the material and actually actively participate in the discussions. The student voice is so important. And, you know, even my board members that I might not see eye to eye to on the topic, when the student speaks, something special happens. Everyone kind of leans forward and listens. And I think that is the best advocacy, is to speak up and be that student voice. In our meetings, it's really helpful for us as trustees to hear how these policies, you know, are made up here, but really impactful at the student level, and also activate the other students. It's really important that students know how these decisions are getting made and what they can do to influence them. It's one thing to hear from one person at a board meeting about a topic. It's quite another when you can round up a few voices to work in concert to effectively change the minds of the decision makers. And so I think those are two of the biggest ways. I try to spread the word to our students about how the decisions get made and encourage them. But I think it's really special when students can say, hey, here's how you do this. Come with me so we can affect this change together.
Thank you so much for that, Trustee Johnson. Trustee Aguinaldo, if you may, please.
Yeah, thank you for the question. I'd say effective advocacy is in telling your story. I remember one of our student board members, his name is Colin Fitzgerald, he was talking about a friend of his who was taking final exams, who needed to sit in front of a fast food restaurant in order to get access to the internet so that he could finish his exams. And it was exactly what Trustee Johnson was talking about, where everyone was leaning in and trying to understand exactly what the problem was here. And his story made everyone question, you know, where are we on the conversation about a wireless infrastructure for the entire state? And I just thought to myself, how's that for sending a ripple? Sharing this one story allowed us to understand something that's so important from a basic needs standpoint on a statewide level. So whenever you have a doubt, speak up, and use your story to communicate the message that you're trying to say, because people are listening. We want to hear what you have to say.
Thank you so much for that. And Trustee Lee, please.
Yes, I think both of them said really well. I just add a few things. First, I want to share a secret with the student, especially the student trustee. You know, although you see us as calm there, but initially, I think we were nervous. Most of us are nervous. I still remember the first time I was on the board, I was so nervous. And first time I was as president, I was so nervous, especially the first 30 minutes. So it's pretty normal, you know, be nervous at there. But, you know, calm down is normal. It's everyone would be there before. And also want to let you know, all we are here, we are here for the students. We're not here for like for other things, because student is really the center. Student success is our goal. And so whatever you need, just let us know. But I do want to share a few tricks that maybe or technique you can use when you talk about how to advocate your goal. First, you may need to know your goal. It's what's your level of your goal or scope of your goal. Is the national level or state level or the district level? Because based on the scope of your goal, you may talk to the different person. And another thing is to set like focus. I remember when I first elected, I had a long list. It's like a 10, 15. And gradually, I understand that. I cut it down. I can focus on one or two, maybe three at the most. And also, you set up a long-term goal. You know, a lot of things at the board level, you make changes. It's not like you ask it, it will be changed tomorrow. It will be a long time. So set up a goal, and then for a long time, even when you leave the trustee seat and the board can continue to carry that, another student trustee can continue to carry that to get it implemented. And another advice I have is to plan your goal into other board's goal. You know, that will make it much easier for you to win the support.
Thank you, trustees, for all your wise and wonderful feedback. Next slide, please. Thank you. Next question. What are some techniques student trustees can use to effectively work with other trustees? This time, Trustee Aguinaldo, may you go first, please?
Yeah, thank you for the question. When I was thinking about this question, I didn't necessarily tailor it down to what student trustees can use to effectively work with other trustees. I think of student trustees, as our colleagues at the table with no distinction as to whether they're students or not. So my advice here would be just to seek to understand and then be understood. Seeking to understand takes different forms, right? You're trying to build a relationship with other trustees. You're taking the time to volunteer for projects. So that you could develop some working experience with one another. You're taking the time to reach out, but then you're also seeking to be understood. And that means that when you're at the table, you are using your voice and you are advocating. So as long as you play between those two things of both listening actively and then taking action on what you've learned combined with your lived experience, I think you'd be a very effective trustee.
Thank you for that. Trustee Lee?
Yes, I think I mentioned that a little bit in the previous question, and I agree with Trustee Agnado is you need to talk with the board members, other board members, and I'm not sure this is true for all other student trustees. For our student trustee, he or she usually join in June meeting, and after that, we more have the summer break. And because of summer break, you have time, I would encourage you to make appointment with every board member to talk with each individual one, understand what their goal, what's their passion, also tell them what's your goal, what you like to implement or kind of have things, get things done. And like I said in the previous question, is try to make yours part of theirs so they can help you. and also build your friendship with other board members. You know, we need five board members, and we need the majority to get things done. Although you cannot break the Brown Act, but you know, build a friendship, understand what they need, and try to convince them, I mean, what you think should be right for the student. Also, I like to emphasize Trustee Agnado said is use a story, the real story really impress others. And you know, like I said at the beginning, we are here for the student. If the student really need that, we would love to go to that direction, help the student.
Thank you, Trustee Lee. And Trustee Johnson, please.
Yes, I absolutely agree with the other trustees. It's so important to build that connection and that relationship with the other trustees. I have to do it with the other trustees. And I think that it's really important for our student to build that relationship too. I make an effort to reach out to the two student trustees that I've had a pleasure to work with so far at the very beginning, and make sure that they feel included and really welcomed as at their first meeting. And I make sure they have my cell phone number and my email, and they know a little bit about me. I had one student trustee at our last year who was able to come to our retreat, and apparently student trustees hadn't been invited, or if they hadn't been able to attend before, but that was a really incredible time. And you know, it happened towards the very end of this trustee's work on the board, but it was phenomenal to get to know the student trustee and build a deeper relationship. One of the things that our student trustee said is, but I don't look like you guys, demographics. Our student trustee was LGBTQ and had some visible tattoos. And I said, well, actually we have LGBTQ people not only on our board, but part of our administration. And I know a lot of my fellow board members and administrators, people here at this retreat have tattoos, they might have long sleeves on, but they are just like you. And that was a way for them to not feel so othered, is by that relationship building. And when people feel included and welcomed and on the same level, if you will, then work can happen a little bit easier. And that trustee reached out to me about a couple of things happening on the campus, but I think it's a direct relationship to, do you feel comfortable approaching somebody else about something or asking a question? So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your guys' answers. Next slide, please. Beautiful. Next question. What recommendation would you give to student trustees who only have an advisory vote, i.e. how do you influence other trustees and the board? This time, Trustee Johnson, may you go first, please?
Yeah, I think this is an ideal place to tell your story. The trustees who have a voting role might not know your lived experience, or have their lived experience might be very different. And so to utilize that story can really influence the decision making members. And it's important, because even if they have a similar lived experience to those making the decisions, they're still not there today. And so they might have forgotten, or it might be a little bit different, or there might be a barrier or something that we're just not aware of. And so to lend their voice there is critical.
Thank you, Trustee Johnson. Trustee Lee?
Yes. First, although the student trustee only has an advisory role, but it's still important. And like I said at the beginning, we are all here for the student. We like to hear student voice, but I do recommend student trustee and to do your homework, understand the issue really well. You know, sometimes you, from the students, you see one angle of the problem, and when you really dive in, you see the other side of the problem. And you know, you may change your view. You may have a better solution for the problem. Also, I would suggest the student to meet with the chancellor before the board meeting and you know, ask questions. No question is stupid question. You know, I remember at the beginning, I asked a lot of weird questions. What about this? What about that? You know, especially with Chancellor one-on-one before the board meeting, ask him or her, say, okay, what about this? What about that? If you don't understand or chancellor does not understand, maybe he or she direct you to a different person. And another thing is I would suggest student trustee invite the board to your event. And you know, we are here, we like to hear the student voice. And if you can invite us to those events, I can hear more firsthand information. It will be better, I think it will be better for us to jump on the issue and help you. And I do suggest the student trustee to, there's two meetings to attend. One is the Sacramento, the January Sacramento CCLC meeting, and the February the DC meeting. Attend those meetings, learn. And of course, Trustee Johnson said, you know, work with the board and build a friendship and work together. Though you're like advisory role, you do can influence the board a lot and kind of direct the decision or change the decision in their mind.
Thank you, Trustee Lee. And Trustee Alvarado, may you please?
Yeah, thank you for the question. My recommendation here is an extension of what Trustee Lee was saying with respect to digging in and understanding what the issue is and asking those questions. My recommendation here would be to become a subject matter expert. I was in the room with Alexis Zaragoza when we were drafting the DEI statement that eventually made its way into Title V. She was an incredible, steadfast, tireless advocate about the statement being student-centered. And I think that makes it very clear at the beginning that it very much is. Colin Fitzgerald was able to teach me about the differences between participatory governance and shared governance. He knew everything there was to know about the differences between those two structures. Julia Tarasova, who's another one of our student trustees, she was an expert in basic needs. I think even Stevens knows probably a lot more about 9+1 than I do, as does everybody else on this call. So whether you think about yourself as a subject matter expert, you're certainly growing into that role, and doing your homework, as Trustee Lee said, to get yourself there is absolutely and critically important. Because once you have those tools with you, it doesn't stop you from working on a resolution for board consideration, even if you're still in an advisory role. Hell, it doesn't stop you from turning your advisory role into a voting role if you play your cards right and know exactly what the process is for making that change. So I think as long as you do your homework, you're doing what Trustee Johnson said, reading the materials, making sure you're there, you're present, and you're engaged is the biggest thing that you can do to influence the board's decisions.
Thank you, trustees, for your eloquent and wonderful answers. Next question, please. I believe this is the penultimate slide or question. What can boards do to empower student trustees? Trustee Avanado, may you go first, please?
Yes, boards can do themselves a favor by having students at every table. We have two students on the search committee for a new chancellor for our system. And I think that was a wise and necessary move. So just make sure that you're being an advocate for getting a seat at the table, because what's the saying, if you're not at the table, then you're on the menu, something like that. And making sure that the people on the board know that you need a seat there, that we need to include the seat there at every level, not just at the general discussions, but on the committees. You know, all of the other discussions, we need to have a diverse, well-rounded group there, and that absolutely includes the students.
Thank you much. Trustee Johnson, if you may, please.
Yeah, so boards can do a few things to empower our student trustees. One is make sure they're invited to the table. If you're not invited, push your way in. just do it. With those relationships that you've built, just ask, hey, can I attend that meeting, or I'd like to learn more, or is there a role for me at this event? You know, just keep pushing if you feel like you're not included. But as board members, you know, we need to be reaching out to our student trustees and making sure that they are included in all those things. An effort that we have been addressing is our student trustees are the only trustees at the table that don't receive a stipend. You know, and so impact, you know, it's you know, not a ton of money. I mean, you know, we don't do this work for the riches, but it's if we're getting a stipend, you know, our student trustee should be getting one too. It's just equitable. And the other thing we can do to empower our student trustees is to check in with them and make sure they're comfortable with the material before the meeting. And that's something that I need to do with our student trustee is just say, hey, wanted to make sure you saw the agenda and check in and see if they have questions. I know that they can always come to us, but I've been on the other side and been that it takes a while to get comfortable and ask the questions if we don't have that relationship built. So it does go two ways.
Thank you, Trustee Johnson. And Trustee Lee, if you may please.
Yes, first I'd like to repeat what Trustee Johnson said before, like as a board, we need to reach out to the trustees. And I remember for the past 2 years, whenever there's a new trustee, before the first meeting, I reach out to him or her, give a phone call and have a casual chat and make sure he or she is comfortable and also welcome him or her is on board. So that's the first thing I would encourage all the board members to do. Another thing is to encourage the student trustee to speak up. And I'm sitting next to my student trustee at least a couple of times in the past couple of months. I just ask her, hey, speak up. You know, it's time for you to speak up. It's you want to not speak anything stupid. You know, we welcome your feedback, your thought. And another thing I would recommend is for the board members to join this student trustee organized event or some event organized by the student. So from the student trustee aside, you need to invite us to those events. Let us know you know the student much better. On our side, that's like the other trustee said, when we have an event, we need to invite the student trustee and make sure he or she is included. And I think that would really help.
Thank you all, trustees. Next slide. Thank you. Now is the time where I'm going to open the floor to the audience to see if there's any questions for the Board of Trustees members here. I know it's very important to hear from a board member's perspective, so I would implore everyone to, you know, keep the questions coming if you have any. I'll give you guys a second. I have a question then. As a former student trustee, I was actually really well received by my board and actually really welcome open arms with my board. However, I recognize and contextualize that's not all the cases for all of campuses, unfortunately. And obviously for you three board members, you obviously care about, you know, student advocacy, or else you wouldn't be here. So my question is, how would a student trustee navigate that aspect if they're having a resistant board? Because that may be an issue. But I do appreciate the intonation where, you know, we're a student trustee and push through and, like, you know, use your tenure and your title to sort of wedge your way to these conversations. However, I would just like maybe you guys to answer, how would other trustees be able to do that? Because that's sort of not a scary thing, but that's a little off-putting thing to really need to do. So I'll leave that to any of you guys to just answer that. Thank you.
I would hope that there's, you know, some boards are 5 members, some are 7 members. I hope that not everyone would, you know, be so resistant to a student trustee. So find something that someone that you might have something in common with, or that might be sympathetic to, you know, your role, or encouraging, even if it's that they've smiled or, you know, acknowledged your presence, and start with them. And also I would say that, you know, there's a student role for a reason. So, you know, talk to your advisor and your student government and the administration to see how you can be included more if the board is not receptive.
Yes, I'd like to add a little bit more, as I hope that does not happen often. You know, we really welcome student trustee, and but it may happen in some places. Just in that case, just like Trustee Johnson said, try to find someone you think may be friendly to you. And if you cannot tell, and what two things you can do. One thing is ask your chancellor, use your chancellor or your college president as your assistant to help you navigate this, understand the board dynamic. Another thing is you may approach someone like a little similar to you, like if you're female, approach a more female board, or if you're like an API, I would like to reach out to some API boards, vice versa, like a Latino African American, something like, try to find something in common and try to approach that board member. Hopefully that can help. I always expect it'll be really rare you got to receive from all the board members.
I'll just insert a quick note. I agree with what my colleague trustees have said. I think it goes back to seek to understand. If it's an issue that is deeper, it has to do with political dynamics, et cetera, your best choice may be to just put your head down and continue working on the board. In other instances, it may follow life's greatest piece of guidance, right? Which is find an ally, find a mentor to help guide you through the process. So while I think it could be fact specific, it really is boils down to something simple, which is seek to understand and then be understood.
Thank you, trustees, for your answers. I see we have a couple of hands. I'm gonna go to student trustee Castades. I'm sorry if I mispronounced that.
Oh, no worries. You pronounced it just fine. So I have a question trying to navigate something right now with my board of trustees. Tomorrow they will be having a retreat to work on goals for the superintendent president, her evaluation process, and how those will align with board goals. However, a few days ago, I was informed that it was closed session, and typically I'm not allowed into closed session. However, I would still like to be a part of, you know, this goal setting as I am a board member, as a student trustee. And they were kind of brushing it off as, oh, you don't have to go, but I would like to go. But typically, you know, I'm not allowed into closed session. How would I go about making it into this meeting?
So depending on the topic, the way I understand closed session, and you know, please chime in, other trustees, if your experience is different, but certain folks can be in for each agenda item. And so I don't think that it wouldn't be inappropriate for you to participate in at least part of that discussion. Even if you couldn't stay for the whole thing, they might have to agendize it a little bit different if there was going to be a discussion and then, you know, some sort of something that was more private. But nothing comes to mind that you wouldn't be allowed to. If they don't want you there, just say, I want to be part of the discussion. And I think that it's important to have a student voice in this space, and let them figure out the legality of it.
Okay, so correct me if I'm wrong, the other two trustees, and to my understanding, what she discussed here, that topic is not closed session items. And we discussed that in the public. The district goal, the counselor, superintendent, college president goal, that's the public session item. And when we talk about the evaluation, that is closed session item. So, I mean, for closed session, it may be hard to get in, but for certain item, it may not or should not be in the closed session. That's my understanding.
I agree with my fellow trustees. I think if you have some questions about what can be an open and closed session, and you have the benefit of having the consultation of a board council, you should ask your board council exactly what you could do in this space. Because ultimately, if you have the option of attending, even if somebody's saying you should not, and you know, wink, wink, maybe you should think about not being there, you should go. Where there's an option, take the option.
Thank you, board members. I hope that answered your question, Student Trustee Casadas. I'm going to call on Student Trustee Mermet. I apologize if I butchered that as well.
Hello, that's okay. No, it's Mummert. my name is Serena Mummert. I am from Citrus Community College District over here in Glendora in Southern California. I just wanted to start by saying thank you, all of you. I really love and appreciate everything that you guys have had to provide today. It's very informative. I believe Robert also said that he had a welcoming board when he was in his position. And so luckily I've had the same experience. All of my fellow trustees were very welcoming in, you know, establishing a relationship with me from the beginning. One of the goals that we have set for, you know, our district and our school, they also want to be very active and they want to attend campus events to get to know our students. So I really appreciate, Andy Lee, what you said about attending the events, because I know that this is an important part and an important time for you to see how the decisions that you are making are really affecting what's going on our campuses. And so I was just wondering if there's anything specific that you guys could add in how us student trustees can more engage our fellow trustees in hearing these student stories, as you've said, that are very important. So we can all experience those learning moments and make sure that all the students are represented. I'm definitely going to invite my fellow trustees to all the events that I hear of. I'm sure that they would love to hear about them. Maybe they are not gonna be able to attend all of them. I respect that. But I would love to know if there's anything else that I can do to better assist them.
So I'm part of my district is 4 college campuses and a couple of centers. And so over, you know, a few counties. And so if you could, what would be helpful for me is if our student trustee could highlight maybe the most important or the events that they would be attending or an opportunity to, because there's just so much happening on all of our campuses all the time. But if there's a conversation that would be helpful for me as a board member to hear, or an opportunity for students to share their stories, anything like that, highlighting that out of the sea of events that are happening on campus would be helpful to me, and making sure that I'm aware of those events.
Oh, thank you. Yes, that seems much more reasonable. I would also really love to hear from you as well, Trustee Lee and Trustee Aguinaldo, if there's anything you have to add.
Trustee Lee, do you want to go first?
You go ahead.
Okay. If I'm understanding correctly, one of your questions was, when should we speak up and tell our stories? And I think the board agenda is replete with opportunities to put your story there. So I think paying really close attention to the matters that are agendized and making sure that you do your homework and saying that the trustees would want to know this side of the student life during this item would help you organize yourself and organize others into making sure that the stories and possibly even the bodies show up to make a comment when that item is up for discussion. If for some reason there is a an agenda item that is not on the agenda that should be on the agenda, and you want to bring it to somebody's attention, please do. Because just because it's not on the agenda doesn't mean that it precludes you from speaking up and telling your story about it. So find somebody. I'm very much aligned with Trustee Johnson's methodology of sharing contact information to say, you know, get a hold of me, talk to me, tell me what your concern is. And if it's appropriate for putting on the agenda, we will absolutely do that and make sure that your stories are part of the ongoing narrative we're trying to develop about how our students are succeeding.
Thank you. Yes.
Yes, I would like to add a couple of things. One thing is just like Trustee Johnson said, we love to see more events, but you when you invite, just not like it, you just send it out, broadcast it out, you can send it out with a little additional information, something like this is a really good event, I strongly recommend to attend. Some may say that, okay, this is just event for your information so that they can pick the most important or the event you expect the most to come. And don't expect them, they come like all the events because this is not a full-time job. Another one is if you have time, I know the student trustee is just kind of like us, we have full-time job, you have a full-time load of the study, and let's still try to find the time, maybe every couple months or quarter, try to have a coffee time or lunch time with the chancellor, with every individual trustee, if it's not like a really big district. I know for some big districts, it may be hard, but if not that far, try to meet the trustee in person instead of just a phone call.
Thank you. That is great advice from all of you. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, board members. And thank you, student trustee Murmert, for that beautiful question. If there are no other questions, this is gonna be the final question that's in the chat. What advice do you have for students as they advocate, since most things they advocate for, they will never see the benefits of, since most changes take years to implement? I will just leave it off to you three to just decide who goes first. Thank you.
Kind of like planting a tree, right? You can plant a tree, and even if maybe you're not at that school, you can still drive by and watch that tree grow. Because we're part of the community, and some of the things that we want to see, we might not see implemented in our time on the board either. But it's about moving together to affect change, and doing it for more than just who's on the campus at this moment, doing it for the people who, haven't been born yet, or, who are going to come after, and then keeping tabs, just to see, staying engaged to make sure that these things are happening. And then nothing's to say that you all serve as student trustees and then get elected later, right? Because those positions, and especially those positions on the board where the trustees maybe didn't value the student voice as much, come for their seats, run, challenge them.
I'd say the flip side of that is not advocating because you're not going to see the change. And I don't think we can afford to be silent. I don't think we can afford inactivity. So I'm not saying that to strike fear in anyone's heart, but we need to do this. And as long as you're doing it for the right reasons, trust that the process will work out and trust that your changes will come to fruition. But start now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If you're here for your own benefit, then it'll be really hard for you. But if you're here for your passion and for the students and for the good of the students, and you'll be very successful. And also like Trustee Johnson said, maybe 5 years, 10 years later, you look back, say, okay, this is a big tree I planted 5 years, 10 years ago, or this is the program I helped to implement or brought it to the district, the college many years ago. Also in the future, like Trustee Johnson said, you you are on the board now and you know how to run in the future. If you want to have a bigger goal to accomplish and more passion, and you can just run for the board. There's a lot of cases like student trustee become the actual trustee later.
All right, if there are no other questions, I just wanted to say thank you to the trustees for coming in and speaking to our, you know, incoming student trustees. I appreciate that so much. I appreciate hearing the perspective of an actual board member, and I think it's extremely advantageous to hear it. So I appreciate you three for coming through. Thank you. And I think I'm gonna pass it back to President Chervalon now. Thanks everyone.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Director Andrade, and thank you all of the esteemed panelists from the Board of Trustees for being here today. And thank you for all the participation and wonderful questions as well. We're gonna go on to our next session, which is gonna be an open forum. And we've allotted some time where we just wanna provide a forum where you can ask if there's any other questions that you may have come to your mind or that you may have wanna ask of the SSCCC. We'd open the floor for that. So if you would either raise your hand or type your question in the chat if you have any during this time. I'm not seeing, or I have seen one. So yes, Trustee Mummer, you're recognized.
Thank you. I just wanted to mention, if anybody is comfortable with connecting via LinkedIn, I will go ahead and drop my link in the chat. I really love to see what everyone is doing because we have very, you know, involved and busy lives. And I think that's a great way that we can all stay connected. And please drop your information as well for LinkedIn so I can add you back. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there any other questions? Feel free to raise your hand or drop it in the chat. I'm not seeing any. So we're gonna go on. We do have a few events that I'd like to tell you all about. We have our professional development and leadership event, which will be occurring September 30th through October 1st in the San Francisco Airport Westin. Our monthly regional delegate assemblies will be resuming and our 2023 General Assembly will be held in March 31st through April 2nd. At the Long Beach Westin. Our next slide is gonna provide you with some information on our website, our Instagram, and our Twitter. I would also recommend that you sign up for our Action Network email distribution list to receive more information on current events as they grow and as we proceed through the year. And once again, thank you all for participating today and attending this webinar.